And this is one of the reasons why, as a product manager, you need to be able to have your documentation. This will serve as evidence to what you're going to be doing later in the future. I have a law background, right? And that has helped me so much in documenting all of my processes, right? Documenting this process, you can easily defend yourself. You can easily defend your product. You can easily defend what you have on paper. So this is the requirements. The requirements I shared with stakeholders. These are the things I came up with, right? You have something to go back to. At the same time, you might have all your grooming sessions with your team, you might have your sprint plan with your team, but you need to have a well-documented process. You need to have a good documentation that you can always refer to, right? And just another story is, when I first got into product management, there are times when I plan a sprint and I realize the engineers, the front-end guys, the back-end guys will call me, what is going on here? What's happening? What should I do here? Because I did not know how to write like a proper documentation for requirement documentation for product management, for products, for my product at the time. Also, my stories, my other stories, my tasks were not well documented for the engineers to understand. So when I give out the task and say, oh, Isa should be able to sign in, for example, right? The documentation that goes after that was not well done by me. And I realized I always have to jump on calls for them to explain. You actually don't want that kind of burden on yourself as a product manager, right? So documentation helps you. Proper documentation helps you. Helps the developers to get better understanding of what they are meant to do, right? And helps your process. So I'll be running through 6 key steps today. The first is talking about functional and non-functional requirements. I'll be talking about metrics and analytics. I'll be talking about key definitions. I'll be talking about user interactions. Under this user interaction, we have user flow and wireframes, and we have designs, because they are key to what you do. This is what actually connects your user interactions together. I'm talking about the release milestone, and finally, release criteria. So touching on these 6 points for writing requirements that you need as a product manager. And over time, I've realized that all of these requirements are substantial to what I do as a product manager. They're substantial to explaining my products well, better to my stakeholders, to my engineers, and they serve as a guide through. And you realize that even when you're doing, you want to leave a particular organization, you want to do your handover, those documents actually stay past the test of time and is what the company will use, right, in helping them understand your processes as you go forward. So the first one is going to be talking about functional and non-functional requirements. So first, what are requirements? Requirements are well thought through documentations in software engineering. They are well thought through documentations in software engineering. And there are two main types. Of system requirements. We have the functional requirements, we have the non-functional requirements. So what are functional requirements? Functional requirement is something the system must do if the system If the system does not meet this requirement, it's referral, right? For example, you take your Facebook application, you take your Instagram application, you should be able to log in. If your application cannot do this, that's a fail from the start. That's a functional requirement. It is key to what that product, it is key to you interacting with that particular product. You take your bank application, you log in, you want to transfer funds to somebody, and you can't do that. That functional requirement is key to using your bank application. If your bank app cannot do that, then there's an issue somewhere or something has broken. It's not meeting its core functionality, right? A system should be able to do these things for it to be able to meet its requirements. If the system does not meet its functional requirements, system has failed. Another example is your WhatsApp. You log into your WhatsApp, you want to send message to somebody, or you want to create a group, send message to people. That is the core functionality for WhatsApp. If the system cannot do that, if WhatsApp cannot do that, it has failed that functional requirement. These are things that your system must do. System must need to pass the check. And that requirement could be, you log into your Instagram account, you can actually log in. You can someone is raising their hands up. I
Good
am.
afternoon. Good afternoon, ma'am. My
Good
please, I don't
afternoon.
understand the concept of the functional requirement properly. Please, can you recap? I'm sorry if like for the disturbance.
Okay. No, that's fine. These are requirements that the system must do. If the system cannot do that, right, it has failed. Right? If you cannot log in to your bank app, you cannot send money with your bank application, it has failed. That's the functional requirement. That is something your bank app should be able to do, to be able to send funds to somebody. It's a de facto requirement for your bank application, right? If your bank app cannot do that, it's does not met like its core function, it's for core functionality, and it has not actually passed the check, right? So you're, it's something that is a must. The system should be able to do that. And going forward, I was saying, even if you can log into your Instagram account, right? You can like pictures. You can like people's videos. You can view people's content on Instagram. And you try to upload your own content or your own picture to Instagram, and it fails, right? Probably the issue is from Instagram themselves. It has failed that functional requirement because one of the core functionalities of Instagram is to be able to upload pictures, not just for you to, not just for you to just like people's and content and all of that. It's a functional requirement, right? If you can't do that at that point, probably there's a bug, there's an issue somewhere, or they're experiencing some technical difficulties, right? They fail to deliver on that functional requirement. So functional requirements, recapping, is something your system must do, right? It's probably based on the core functionality of your system, it must do it to pass the check. If your system cannot do it, if a system rather, sorry, cannot do that, right, they are failed, right? So let me give an example of something I've worked on. I've worked on a vehicle tracking application. Okay, so for example, let me use my current company. I work in a payment company. If you take your ATM card to use in a POS machine, and we are the back end for a lot of POSs, and our switch is not passing the right message to where it's supposed to pass the message to. Our switch is not interacting with MasterCard to interact with your bank. Our switch is not giving you details as to why you cannot withdraw from your ATM card and from the POS machine. We have failed on that functional requirement at that particular point, right? Because our core functionality as a company is to ensure that when you take your card to go and withdraw in any of our POSs or any of ATM that we route transaction for, right? You should be able to do carry out that transaction. Or we should be able to give you like details as to why that transaction is not pulling through. Like, if that requirement is not available to our customers at that time, there's an issue with our system and we've not met a key functional requirement that we owe our customers. Right, so moving forward, right, so functional requirements must follow business rules. So I gave an example of logging into a system, I gave an example of sending funds, I gave the example of being able to upload pictures on Instagram and all of that. Other functional requirements would be reporting. If you have a reporting system and the report is not pulling through, the function there's an issue with that requirement. For example, I worked on re reporting for a vehicle tracking system before, right? There were times where our reports were not accurate. There were times when a customer would be like, "Oh, I have 100 devices on your application." When I check the report is telling me I just have 10. And the customer can be like, "Oh, I have 50 device. I have 50 vehicles on the road at this particular time. I know this for a fact that the 50 vehicles are driving on the road." But when I check the report, I can see just two driving, right? What's going on, right? I know I sent 50 drivers out, but the report is giving me two. That's a functional requirement for our system. There's an issue somewhere. We fail to deliver that particular value at that particular point. And this is how I jot down my functional requirements. I put my functional requirements in forms of user stories, right? So every functional requirement that my system must do, right? For example, a user should be able to upload their devices and a user should be able to attach your device to a particular vehicle. I put my functional requirements in stories so I can explain to my developers in my description and say a user should be able to upload their devices to our system and attach that device to a particular vehicle. When I put that as a story, I'll now go to my description. User should be able to upload that device by giving so information, like the SIM card number of that device, like the IME number of that device, like the make and model of that device. And I'll explain why we need to make a model of that device. For me, the reason why I needed to make a model of that device was for us to be able to configure the device, right? If the make and model is not a protocol that we have cracked as a company, without the user, we don't have this protocol available on our system now. Kindly upload device with this particular make and this particular model. Yes, please.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening.
From what you've said and from what we've been taught, user stories usually come with acceptance criteria. So from what you've said today, it sounds like acceptance criteria and functional requirements are like very similar. Are they the same? Or is it like acceptance criteria are used to express functional requirements or features? That's my question.
Okay, they are used to express. I'll put it that way. Right? You know, when I said in my description, I put it as a description that this is what I do. And the reason why I do this is simply so different things rock their boat. And I'll tell you why I do this, right? To actually explain to my developers why we need this particular requirement and how it should work. And why I did that for that particular company was because it was an IoT company, and none of us except me at that particular point had worked on an IoT device, right? So I needed to break down each functional requirement for my development team at that particular point. So when I write out my functional requirements, okay, so this is what I do. When I give my description of my product, I write out the functional requirement, then I write out my user story. So functional requirements are different from my user story. So let me just explain this properly. But within my user stories, right, I pick some functional requirements. Within my story, I pick some functional requirements and give a better description of what they should do. For example, a functional requirement for me one time was monitoring. And under monitoring, I was able to come up with 10 stories under monitoring. So the system was, actually, the functional requirement was being able to log in, was being able to monitor device. But under that monitoring, I had user stories. So they're not the same thing per se, right? Your functional requirements would actually go into different stories to explain what that functionality or what that core functionality actually means, right? So the reason why I said I broke it down for them is this, I think, if I can remember the requirement document I had that time, I had about 5 functional requirements. And one of those functional requirements, right, just to explain better to our devs, because when I had meetings with my stakeholders and executive teams, they were not on the call. Just to explain what this is, I broke it into 10 different stories for them to understand why this requirement was going to go this particular way. Where I currently am now, right, I have my functional requirement, I have my user stories, but they're just separate things. They're just 2 different things. My functional requirement does not come in my story. My functional requirement is just explaining why we need to have a particular product, why we need to do something. And it's just separate, entirely different from my stories are just something different. The functional requirement is just something different. So I put a description of why this functional requirement is. So for example, I'm working on a particular product, right? And it's a fintech and product different from our core fintech products, right? I have my functional requirement as to this is a functional requirement for the system. The system will be able to pass this, right? I gave a description for each functional requirement I can't actually release the information now. I think I had about 6 functional requirements at that point, right? Because I need to do all a commission of all documentations for everything we're going to do. And the stories were actually different from my functional requirements. So when you're reading documentation, you know, these are the functional requirements for this particular product. It's different. When you want to see the user stories for my developers, it's a different thing, right? So my functional requirements was gone down to for review by myself and my stakeholders as to these are the check marks for our system. This is what we want to achieve. These are things that you must pass and get approval from my stakeholders, yes, before moving to the next step. I don't know if I was able to demystify the truth for you.
Yeah, I understand it better. Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much. So for non-functional requirements, on the other hand, describe how the system will work. So they describe how the system will work, right? But it's a way of giving your user, let's say, better service. For example, what application loads first? Okay, for example, let's say TikTok, right? I want TikTok to be able to have, as I work in TikTok, I want them to have this particular capacity. I want it to have unlimited numbers of users. I want it to have to run at this particular speed. I want it to be durable. Those are non-functional requirements. They don't affect the core value or the core function of what your product is offering, right? For example, it does not affect the, or I should be able to upload a picture on TikTok. I should be able to do certain things on TikTok. I should be able to like a picture on TikTok. I should be able to, let's say, stitch a video on TikTok. I should be able to duet a video on TikTok. Those are functional requirements, right? But the wrong functional requirement is not speaking to, oh, what's the speed to which this application loads? What's the capacity of this particular application? So are you trying to tell me for capacity, if we have 5 million users on the application at the same time all over the world, is the application shaking? Is the application slowing down for other users? Is the application having some glitch just because we have this number of people online at this particular time, at this given time? Is the speed of the application going slower because, oh, we have 5 million people logged in at the same time doing different things on TikTok? So your functional requirement speaks to additional value that your system can give, but it describes how your system should work, right? So let me give an example for my car tracking application. I realized there was a time we had a problem where when we first started, we realized when our users were uploading devices, because we track upload at the back end to know what's happening, right? We realized when we got to 5,000 devices, right, we had issues with monitoring. We had a glitch. Then we had issues where, you know, a customer can just call me, oh, I have this number of device, right? I can't configure them. Or the configuration is going on slowly and I've received a message on my device, but the system is not telling me, oh, I cannot monitor this device. We realized we had a capacity issue. The system had a particular limit in total and had a limit per user. Right, I think I even had a time where a user was like, oh, I can't do past 100 devices in a day. Right, we still had our core functionality that was working, but at that particular time, there was a limit to what the users can do because of the capacity of devices they had on the system at that time. It was something we needed to work on, right? So it speaks to how the system should work. So, in that scenario, we should not be having issues on the system when a user is trying to upload 100 devices in a day. Right, they pay for the system, they should be able to do more than that. We should increase our system capacity. We should not have issues on the system when somebody has 5,000 devices and is telling me I can't track these devices because the system is loading really slow and I can't monitor my system. I can't monitor my devices on the system. Or is that telling me, oh, the speed of the system is so slow because at this particular point, I am a commercial business owner and I have 500 devices on the road and I can't track them. I can't do playback for them. I can't do certain number of configuration in a day, right? The capacity at that point for something we need to look into as enough, that non-functional requirement was actually choked. And usability and that non-functional requirement that we have speed, I've spoken on speed before, right? So functional requirements, right, as I said, just to recap, is something a system must do. And if the system does not do this, the system has failed. Non-functional requirement on the other hand speaks to how a system should work. So that's just the difference between having a functional requirement and non-functional requirement. So the next point I would like to touch on is metrics and analytics. So metrics are the data you collect, and analytics are the insights you derive from that data. So metrics are used to gauge the success of a product, right? So how do I measure my metrics? So there are different analytical tools we can use to measure your metrics and take analytics of your system at a particular time. How you gauge success, how you gauge durability, how you gauge usability, right? So for example, I gave instance of a system crashing down because we're gotten to a particular number limits, right? that was a metric I needed to track across board. I think at that point, and then I called all of my agents at that point and wanted to know, okay, what was this number limit that you had? And where did you start having difficulty? At what limit or at what point did you start experiencing difficulty? It was something I needed to document across board to gather my insights as to, okay, this is data I'm getting. You are telling me when you get to 100 devices, you can configure more in a day. Right, those were like related numbers that go from people. When you get to a certain amount, you can monitor. When you get a certain amount of vehicles on the road, right, you can monitor at this particular point. So those are data that I needed to get together, right, to be able to work properly and deliver value for my customers at a particular time. Right, so the different, depending on the system you're working on, depending on what you're doing, the different analytical tools that you can use to track your metrics of a particular system. So we have four type of metrics I'll touch on. We have the viewership metrics, you have engagement metrics, we have, okay, let's three, and you have sales metrics. Depending on what you're tracking, depending on what your system is doing. For the viewership metrics, right, it's just wanting to know, you have a system, for example, let me use the common system. Let's say Facebook, for example, because Facebook, I think, is one of the widest social media networks we have. As a product manager in Facebook, I want to track some metrics. So for the viewership metrics in Facebook, I want to know the pages my users are viewing. Are they really on Facebook feeds? Do my users view I think this thing like reels on Facebook, like status, are they on that place? Are my users in the search menu? Where are my users actually, what are my users actually viewing? I want to also see their engagement with the page that they view. Guys, talking on engagement metrics, right? After the, we want to be able to know, okay, when my user is on the Facebook feed, how long do they stay there? Right? What are the activities they do there? What are the activities they carry out there? What are the things they do on the engagement? What are the things they engage in? If they see an ad, are they quick to scroll away? Or are they likely to scroll through advertisements on that particular page, right? There are actually analytical tools that use to measure these metrics, like to know the pages your users view and pages your users engage in, and also the rest of the sales metrics, right? At what point are your users actually buying on? Or making sales or making sales engagements on your page, right? At what point are they, you need to understand, at what point are they dropping their cart to make sales, to do something on your system? So where I am currently, right? One engagement we usually track is sales metric, right? And we want to know at what point, okay, let me put it this way. So we work with banks, right? We want to know at what point a bank is saying, let us come and withdraw a particular POS. We don't want to use it. We want to know at what point the bank is saying, let us use your POS. We want to know at what point or which environment the bank is saying, let's deploy more POSs to this particular place. And we also track at what points or reasons why we are withdrawing POSs, or we are deploying to a particular point. These are things we track, right, to help ourselves or to help our businesses, or to help our business as a company, right? Those are metrics we track to track our customer behavior. Customer behavior in this sense are the banks that we work with, right? Those are the metrics we track to understand, okay, what is this particular bank saying? Why is this bank saying we should do this at this particular point, right? And on our points, we're like, what we need to do, right, to increase sales, to increase interaction at this particular point. Right, so before I go to the next point, if we have any touch points on metrics or any confusion, I can just go back to it before I go to key definition. Any questions on metrics and analytics? Okay, so
I wanted to ask a question. I wanted to ask, in an organization where there's maybe like a data analyst, Is it like, how does the PM factor, how does the PM does, is it still the PM that does the metrics or the data analysis?
So I've worked in three places as a PM, and two of those places, right, I only worked in one where there was a data analysis. Where currently I am, there's no data analytics. The tracking company I worked in Kenya, there was no data analytics. But working in VerifyMe, right, there was a data analytics that tracked all of these response, right? But each time a data analysis tracked this response, right, it still has to come to the PM or the head of product at that particular point. We need to understand this metrics and see how products can come in, right? Where currently we have a team. Okay, I work on the settlement model for my company, right? We have a team that tracks this metrics alongside me, together with them, right? When we get this metrics, we find solution on what we do, especially when we're having issues as to, oh, we draw this particular POS, maybe from a particular bank, we don't want to use them. We want to understand the behavior. You just can't lose business like that. We want to know what's going on, right? Like certain banks are saying this particular thing, we want to know what's going on. At a point where I was in a company called Dems Analytics, where we're working on devices, it was a startup, right? And the thing with startups is, startups don't really have, sometimes, let's say, the funding, right, to do certain things. And this is one funny thing about product management is, at the end of the day, they try to dump a lot of things on product managers. So as a product manager, I was working as a business manager, and I was doing tracking metrics, right? Tracking the metrics in the sense that if a customer complains about something or customers are complaining, I have to engage all of them at that point and engage my lead engineer to know what's happening, to know the points where the system is breaking, to know where we're having issues or there's a limit issue. So I did the tracking, right, for that particular company. So it depends on your organization. It depends on where you are, right? But when I was in a company where there was a data analytics, right, I did not bother myself about that. Although when the data analytics comes with its data and explains this to the product team that this is what is happening, right, we try as much as possible to think of solutions that we can use or think of what we can do, right, to counter that particular problem. If it's really an issue or a core problem that's going to affect the business, right? If it's not a core for problem that affects the business, or we're just tracking performance across board, right? If something we'll just sit down and take our time, like, to see, okay, how can we do to counter this issue? So it depends on the organization you are, right? You'll be required to do this in some organization, but for some organization, they have somebody who's already doing this and they're good. But even if you have someone that's doing it as a product manager, you have to be in tune with what he's doing. You have to be in tune with what he has calculated. You have to be in tune with the data or the insight he has gotten, and you have to find a way around working on your business in accordance to data or the metrics and the analysis it has provided you. So it depends on where you are. So that is just simply saying, as a product manager, at the end of the day, you should be able to just flow through, let's say, flow, if it's correct, flow through the waters, right? Or flow in the waters to be able to pull yourself together, depending on where you are, to be able to, okay, I can do this at this point to actually deliver quality products to my customers. I don't know if that's fine, Precious.
Yes, that answers my question. Thank you so much.
Based on personal, let's say, experience, I've only worked with the data analytics once. So key definition, right? This is defining the objective of a particular product, defining the core functionality of this volume of your product, defining the core requirement or defining the core value of what your product stands to gain, what your product wants to do, or what you're doing in the market. This is defining your product as a whole, right? And this is how I've been able to do this over time. When creating my documents for stakeholders to review, right? First, I think I should just say this, right? As a product manager, you can't do things on your own. as a product manager, although people want you to have like a certain amount of experience, a certain amount of expertise in the market, but the truth is, as a product manager, you still need to be able to understand certain things from your stakeholders, right? To be able to define your, I'm talking about key definition, right? To be able to define your product adequately or properly, right? You should, it's something you get from your stakeholders. You should meet your stakeholders and understand what's the aim to achieve. So if I go to key definitions, how do you get your key definition? How do you define your key definition for your particular product, right? It's meeting with stakeholders, because requirements sometimes come from their corporate customer, wherever it's coming from. I'm like, what do we think? What do we seek to achieve here? What do we seek to do here? What are we driving at, right? Once you get that, right, you need to do some other research. Then you want to come up with your key definition as to, this is what we want to do, this is what we want to achieve. And you define it adequately or appropriately, right, to meet business needs. For example, right, I really like to give an example of my experience. I think what it helps better is working on vehicle monitoring, tracking and configuration, right? When the product was brought to me, although IoT, I didn't understand a lot of things going on. So what I did was, I spoke to stakeholders at that particular point. What do you want to achieve? What are we going in at? What is it? They were like, okay, core functionality, core value, core product definition, monitoring. I was like, okay, monitoring, then what? Configuration. I need to understand what the product was trying to, what we're trying to achieve as a company, right? To be able to give a better definition of what we were doing, right? So my key definition here is defining the objectives of your product, right? And to get the objectives right, to be able to understand what you're doing, to get the objectives right, you should be able to meet your stakeholders, do your user research, do your requirements research, do your stakeholders balancing meeting and understanding them what they need to do, and defining it appropriately for those that work on your projects. And when you define a product like that, you still have to go back to your stakeholders and say, this is what I was able to come with. These are the core values, these are the core definitions that we're defining for the particular, these are the core objectives for this particular product. This is what we said it is, right? Does this pass through a short test of time? Is this what we seek to achieve? Is this the core objective, and is this definition in line with what we need to do as a business, right? You still review with them. They say, this is fine, or you do a review. This is what we want to do. This is the exact definition. Then you're good. But it's something you need to be able to do appropriately. And this is one thing that has shot me in the leg as a product manager, right? If you cannot define your product adequately, right, the truth is people around you are going to know. So I remember when I first started this, my IoT product, this actually was my first experience as a product manager. I realized I could not define, I could not explain, and I could not understand what the product was going to do, because I did not understand the essence of meeting with stakeholders and understanding or defining the core value of the product, right? I was just using the word, oh, I'll be able to wing it. The developers around me, okay, I didn't understand the value we're trying to achieve for this particular product, right? Even my documentations were not defining what the product was going to do appropriately. And I was just shooting myself in the leg. I was just doing trash at that particular point. And it was visible to everyone around me that I did not understand the core functionality or the core value. And I could not define the core value for that particular product, right? It took me a lot of time, a lot of learning, and a lot of like sitting down on my own and speaking to mentors, to understand, like, see, you can't do this on your own. You meet your stakeholders to get insights on what they want to do. Then you define it appropriately to meet business needs, right? So next is, I would have loved to have a slide for this, like show interaction of how this is user interaction, user flows, wireframes, and design. I'm sorry I could not come up with a slide, but I'll do the best I can, right, for the user interaction. But before I define like user interaction, currently where I am is my colleague currently just called like a team, because stakeholders were rushing. And please try as much as possible. Even stakeholders are rushing, you always document your process. So God has been rushing, so like, oh, we need to do this. This is what this is. And so like, everybody was like, oh, I have an idea, I've done this before. But the thing is, ideas that are not properly documented will always lead you in a terrible place, right? And so like, oh, I will write my user stories on this and we work with user stories. And as we're going along the way, somebody now called our attention. This was somebody who said, I have an idea of this. I've worked on this before. And he asked, at this point, I think I need a user flow for what I'm going to do or for what we're going to do, because products are dynamic. The fact that UBA has a mobile application, First Bank is also a financial bank that has a mobile application, Zenith Bank has a mobile application, does not mean they have the same user flow or their users interact the same way, right? They do the same thing, right? You might have had that, I have an idea, this is what it is. You must have worked on it somewhere else, but user interaction, the user flows, they're actually just different things. I remember when I first joined TikTok, my brother was telling me, oh, TikTok is for kids. I didn't join for a very long time. I had my first TikTok account this year after they told me that I didn't know I could even make money on TikTok. Well, it's too late. And I think one thing somebody was telling me, oh, it's the same thing as Instagram. Getting on the application, I realized it's not the same thing as Instagram. They're two different things, right? The user flow, the user interaction, or what they simply achieve on TikTok is quite different from Instagram as a whole, right? That is something you need to understand as a product manager. You want to build a particular product. What is your user flow? So let me just give an example of the user flow. It's so sad that I don't have a slide. This would have explained it better, right? So for example, let me just explain like the major shapes. For your user flow, what I like to tell people is the square shape or the rectangle shape, right, means process. The oval shape is to start a process or to end the process, oval, right? Then there is the diamond shape, right? There's the decision box. Yes, yeah, this is the decision box. So we have like, see the oval shape to start. We have the rectangular shape for your process. Then we have these are the major ones that I use on a daily basis. I think it's a rhombus or so. It's the decision shape. For example, I start a process and I say start with the oval shape or a circle. I go to my process, login or sign in, depending on the process I'm running in. The next process with the oval, still with the rectangle shape, is overview page. So when a user logs in, I direct my arrow to an overview page. That's the first thing they should see in an overview page. From the overview page, I direct, let's say, three different arrows, one to device up, one to in device inventory page, and another one to device my monitoring, all with my process shape. And at that point, I say, let me explain what my device inventory will do. I now put another process and says, upload devices, or upload devices in bulk. After I do that, I put another process of configure device. In my configure device, right? Configure device by announce the configure device by connecting to assistant IP. At that particular point, right, when the configuration is going, I should have a decision shape that says, did the configuration does the IP number exist? If yes, ping the IP, ping the SIM card number for a device with that particular IP. If no, tell the user configuration has failed. Right, that's what is that I use my decision shape for. Like if something, okay, if yes, this should happen. If the user does not meet this particular criteria or the process does not meet this particular criteria, what should happen? Right, so that's what I use my user flow, my user interaction to help my developers understand how a process should work, to help them understand the process for each and every step of the way, number one, to help them also understand the decision that should be carried out on the back end if something happens. For example, if the user is logging in, does the user have an account? If yes, let them log in. If no, comment. If no, tell them username and password does not match. Then also tell them sign up. I don't know if you get my point, right? I should be able to explain my processes to my developers in terms to which they understand, right? Also, another thing I use user flow for. I have my user flows, I have design flows to explain to my designer how the design should be. Like my design flow, I explain how each process should come. When you log in, this is the next process, right? To help my designers, right? Then we have wireframes. Wireframes, like I said the last time, helps your designers understand how your design should be and how which the interaction should go. Like you have your wireframes and there are different tools you can use for your wireframe. You can use Balsamic, you can use Figma if you're really good at using Figma for wireframes. And Figma has a lot of plugins that you can use for good wireframe. And you can use your sketch. Like if you're not doing maybe an update to a particular design, you can carry your draw, your notepad on your system. You can draw, you can sketch out some things and direct them on how it should go. And that thing I use for wireframing that is just very funny to a lot of people is actually use Google Slides for wireframe, right? Especially when I'm just interacting with my designer. Okay, I want to do this particular thing, especially for web application, not for mobile app, and I need to draw a wireframe for functionalities that we need to have on our system, and I need to arrange how I want a particular functionality to be. I do wireframes on Google Slides, right? And be like, this is what I want. The designer will do a better job. Right. So these things your user helps with user interactions. Your user flow helps user interactions, helps your developers to understand, okay, once this happens, these are the processes you should take. And once the user gets to this particular pace, these are the next points. And this is the decision we should take on the back end for this particular user. Like if the user is taking this, does this user pass the vibe of this particular place? User should go through it. If user does not pass, what is the error message we need to tell the user? What is the information we need to release to the user? What is the instruction we need to give the user? Okay, carry out this particular instruction to be able to move to the next process, right? What is the necessary error we need to show to the user? Okay, you can't move to this next process because of this. This is why this is happening, right? We need to be able to state out our processes, right, to help our users interact better with our system. And wireframe, on the other hand, is just an internal tool that helps you and your designer, right, understand how a design should be, understand the process or the flow or design flow of how your design should be. And so that's just for my user interaction. I don't know if anybody has any question for user flow and wireframe. So sad I could not project anything today before I go to our last 2 points, which is release milestone and release criteria. So if there are no questions, I'll just go to the next point. Release milestone. Before I explain release milestone, I'll tell you something I do. In my new company, right, I have my milestone for what I want to achieve throughout this year. Right, those milestones are there. Those milestones are properly documented. Those milestones are properly defined, right? And I do this because the stakeholders need to understand what we need to achieve at every point in time. They need to understand what we need to achieve for the product at a particular time. And I review my stakeholders. So my milestone for the third quarter, right, is different from the milestone I have for now. The different milestones are described as, so this milestone that's for this particular product. We have that, put it in a good presentation documentation. Everybody has that. So how to tie to the fact that I have to deliver on this particular note. So for release milestone, a milestone is a significant event in the release of a product. This includes major deliverables. So if probably you're with somebody and the person gets a new job or a well-paying job, or you congratulate the person for achieving this particular milestone. Or you have a new couple, they just had their first child, it's a milestone. You congratulate them, welcome to parenthood, it's a milestone, right? It's like you've achieved something. Or you have two single people that just got married, welcome to this new happy married life, welcome to this new milestone. They've achieved a new milestone, they've gotten somewhere. When they give birth, right, we come to parenthood, is a new milestone. When the child starts to go to school, right, or their children start to go to school, congratulations, this is a new milestone for you. this is where responsibilities of some sort comes. When a child or their children finish university, go to university, they finish up, these are milestones. When those kids get to marry, for example, in simple terms, these are not different milestones. These are just societal milestones to explain, like, oh, you understand what it means to achieve, to say someone has achieved a particular milestone. All of these processes, all of these steps, all of these achievements are milestones. When that child gets to finish school and gets a good job, right? Like, oh, your child has achieved a milestone. Congratulations to you. You understand? So these are milestones. So, as I said, milestone is a significant event in the release of a product, and this includes major deliverables. Now, how do you document your milestones? How do you put your milestones to paper? Is number one, you have to identify the key milestone. When you identify this milestone, secondly, you should be able to define each and every milestone. And third, which is very important, is get feedback and approval from your stakeholders on these milestones. Number four is assigning these milestones to, breaking it down and assigning it to the appropriate person that's going to work on it. And the fifth one is visualizing what this milestone will look like. For example, I work in fintech, right? Let's say a milestone we want to do is one that we've achieved is we can process payments withdrawals on POSs, on ATMs. Another milestone could be, as a company, we want to be able to have a payment gateway. Let's say like Flutterwave, for example. That would be another milestone that we'll have to work towards. And after writing that milestone down, you should be able to define that milestone, right? We've identified the milestone. Okay, oh, there's the payment part, there's the payment processing part, there is having a payment gateway part. You need to be able to identify them, define those milestones, right? Go back to your stakeholder, which is very important. Like, these are the milestones. These are the set time to achieve this particular milestone. This is milestone one, is payment transactions, processing payment transactions. Milestone two is having a payment gateway. You can say to process a payment transaction will take us 4 months to achieve this particular milestone. Put a time and date to your milestone, number one. Milestone two is having a payment gateway. We're going to work on this payment gateway after this. But if we can process transactions, I'm looking at the fact that having a payment gateway might not take up to 4 months. Okay, you can do this in 3 months. Define the milestone, define the time. Then you don't come to your milestone and define, oh, this is what this milestone is all about. This is what this is all about. These are the achievements we seek to. These are the things we seek to achieve for this particular milestone. Define them properly. Then take it to your stakeholders and get approval. Like, should we go this way? And one thing I realized, when you take things to stakeholders, stakeholders always have their vision for a particular product. And they might say, let's do it this way. Let's do this before we do this. It's better. They can say, okay, this is actually easier. Let's switch it up. We are saying we should do the payment routing first before payment gateway. Why not we have this before this, right? And you should be able to get valid reasons as to why a milestone is changing. Or somebody is saying let's do a milestone this particular way. You understand? Get your feedback from your stakeholders. When there's an approval, everybody has come to terms with it, then you fly with it. And before I go further, right, I'd just like to mention that you should know who your stakeholders are. And who are your stakeholders? We have your executive stakeholders, who is, let's say, your CEO, your COO, the people that sits at the board, right? You have engineering stakeholders, which you must understand, which are your engineering team. There are times when, why I say you should be able to identify this, my previous company, my boss was like, let's do a particular thing. And the CTO was on point. I had to pull other engineering members into a meeting with him and explain to him why this particular milestone cannot fly now. And explain to him that if on the engineering part of things, if we do things this way, we are going to flop. We have to take this thing backward and work on this first before we do this. There are times where we need to explain with other stakeholders, probably engineering team, that see this particular milestone should shift to this place. You have your marketing stakeholders, those are the people that put your product market, those are the people that put your carrier products put on a shelf. And you have your sales stakeholders, these are people that take things from your shelf and take for your customers. Let me put it that way, right? So you should be able to identify the proper stakeholders that are taking a milestone to you. Most times are your executive stakeholders. But if there are times that you need to pull in engineering stakeholders to say, on the technical part of things, right, let's hit a milestone before this particular milestone, you should be able to explain, okay, I'm putting this person in, and this is why we need to have them in. Just explain some technical bits to us. After getting feedback from your stakeholders is assigning the milestone, breaking them down into tasks, breaking them down into deliverables, right? And then assigning to the proper person. So let's say I mentioned something about payment gateway. They say the transfer parts, there's the wallet parts, there's the funds and disbursement parts. So different things under payment gateway. Break this milestone, right, into deliverables, into bits, right, and assign to the right person. Visualize your milestone. You should be able to have a clear picture of what you're trying to achieve. You should be able to know what it looks like. You should have an idea of what you're going for, right? You should have a visual representation of what you want to get, right, and what you want to achieve. And your product needs to meet that visual representation you've had in your head, right? So that is all. That is what I have for the release milestone. And my final point is release criteria. And a lot of times people fail to document release criteria. What does this product need to meet to pass the tests? What does this product need before we can deploy? What do we need to meet before we can release this out to people, right? What are the steps or what are the things our product needs to have before we go to deployment, before we go to our customers? Just today, for example, right, we're supposed to run a deployment as a team for a particular product, right? And we realize our product was not meeting certain release criteria. Although we worked on other things, right? We worked on other functionalities, but this was the core functionality of core fix that we're supposed to make, right? We stopped the release of this particular feature because one release criteria has not even been met. That's so funny. So we had five things to work on, right? But a core functionality was not part of the fix, right? It was not part of what we promised to release. We are now saying, see, the best thing for us is, instead of saying we're releasing the other core services, right, this number five is very important, and it was the cradle of what we're doing, right? We're holding it back and say, we're not going to do a release now. We're not going to do a deployment now. We need to meet this particular release criteria, right? We had the funny thing is, you had a back and forth on this today as to say, see, we can't release other services if we don't have this service. And we're even saying something like, see, this service is so important that we can release this service alongside two other services that were identified, leaving the other services out, because it's a major thing that must come with our release, right? It's something we defined, something we identified and said, this must come with a particular release. Because of that, we could not release our customers. So your release criteria are for providing objective measurements about when a product is ready to be released, right? And it's something you can document. I document release criteria in tabular form. I put my release criteria. These are the release criteria that I identify. Then on the other part of the table, I define each release criteria. And I pick out points each of these criteria must meet. For example, I was talking about we had five services to deploy. Now, in each of these five services, these are my release criteria. These are the five things I must release to my customers. I already identified all five things to my team in a table. And on the other part of the table, I define each one. Another each one, I define each requirement that all of these things must meet before we can release. For one of them, I think I identified about three things. For some, it can be one. For some, it can be more, right? But for the core functionality that we're releasing, I was able to identify, I think, about six or seven things, right, that we've not met that is actually stopping our release at this particular point. should be able to identify the release criteria, and you should be able to define them and identify the check marks, let's put that, they must meet before you start out the market, right? Those are all questions. These are all questions that your customer at the end of the day, right? You should be able to identify them and you ensure that whatever you are churning out to the market, whatever you're taking out to the market, meet each of these criteria. At the same time, they must meet all of the check boxes for each of these criteria before you take it out to the market. So that brings me to the end of today's topic, which is writing requirements. I touched on functional and non-functional requirements, metrics and analytics, key definition, user interaction, release milestone, and release criteria. Just to recap, I said functional requirements is something the system must do. If the system does not meet this requirement, it will fail. For non-functional requirements, I said it describes how the system works. And this speaks to probably like speed, durability, capacity, and visibility of that particular product. I said metrics are data you collect, and analysis are insights you derive from this data. I spoke on key definition, which is defining the core functionality of your product or the core value your product offers. I touched on user interaction, the user flow, what each of these shapes in the user flow means, and how the processes should go. Wireframes. I said tools you can use for wireframes. We have Balsamiq, Figma. And for me, for web applications, I use Google Slides, right? On the release milestones, I said you should identify your milestone, define each of these milestones, get feedback and approvals from your stakeholders, assign each milestone to the necessary team working on it, and break up each of these milestones down. I talk about being able to visualize your milestone, and for a release criteria is providing an objective measurement about when a product is ready to be released. You should be able to define each of your release criteria and point out checkpoints each of these release criteria needs to meet, right? Needs to attain the standard they need to meet before you churn them out into the market, before you say customers should come and actually take this particular product. These are criteria your product must meet at the bare minimum, right? Before you can churn them out to your customer, before you can churn a service out, right? So these are the things I've spoken on today. So this brings me to the end of writing requirements, right? So I'll take questions that we have. Hello. Okay, Precious.
I wanted to ask about the release criteria. Is it similar to acceptance criteria, or is acceptance criteria part of, or maybe like the work products that you use to develop the release criteria?
Okay, so let me explain the difference. For acceptance criteria, you use to define a particular feature and say it must meet this particular check, and the feature must meet this particular requirement, right? Those are your acceptance criteria. You define a feature or you define a story. Let me put it that way. This is the story. It must meet this particular requirement. These are the acceptance criteria for it to pass, especially when you're doing your QA testing. You can't be the one doing your QA testing. You might have a QA tester, right? These are the things that this must do to pass this particular checkbox. This is what must happen for it to pass or scale through. Those are your acceptance criteria to back your story up, number one, to explain better to the people working on this. That is most likely your developers, for them to understand what to do and how to go about particular things. But for release criteria, for me, is probably releasing a particular service out to your customer and identifying these are the releases we need to do. Okay, so let me give an example of the back and forth I had today. Is we just release something, right? We worked on the functionality or these functionalities before, right? But we need to make a different release for a sub-product under what I was doing, right? I've done my acceptance criteria, my developers had worked on it, we've done our QA testing, although some of this testing fails. But for release criteria, we're saying this is the release I want to make. Say, for example, putting monitoring in mind. For monitoring, I have, let's say I have six user stories, I have my acceptance criteria there, and I want to deploy or release that particular service to my customers. And I'm saying, aside these acceptance criteria for the user stories to help you work, for the release, this is what I want to see. This is the core functionality I want to give out, right? Which might be probably my testing phase. Let's say out of my 6 user stories, 4 of my testing fails, but a core functionality, which is seeing device location. As a user, I should be able to see device location. Determining my user location and some other things. I think that are something I want to release to my customer at that particular time. And aside that, there are other things or other services I need to give to my user. My release criteria is, see, this needs to pass this particular checkpoint, right? Before I release it to my users. This needs to meet a particular, pass this vibe check before I release out to my users. So the difference is my acceptance criteria is something that I use to explain and define my story for developers to work on. My release criteria are checkpoints that I want a particular service or services to meet up, right? Or quality, let me put that way. I want a particular service to meet up with before giving it out to the users.
I understand better now. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Any other person with a question? Do you have another question? Okay, so I'm seeing are milestones the same thing as roadmaps? No, they are not the same thing as roadmaps, right? And your milestone, right? Okay. I was giving two examples of two milestones I intended to achieve this year. I have payment routing and I have payment gateway. Under my payment routing, which is a milestone that I said, okay, give me 4 months, I'm going to give you this. I have my roadmap for that particular 4 months, for that milestone, where I broke down all of the tasks we needed to do. Within 4 months, put that 2 week time frame, for some of them, there's a 1 week time frame. When I saw the capacity of what that was going to be done is light compared to having a 2 week sprint. Right, like in 1 week we can achieve this particular thing, right? So they're not this thing. You have your milestone, but your milestone can be broken down into a roadmap. So when you have a milestone to achieve something, let's say within a month, or you want to achieve this particular milestone within 2 months, 3 months, depending on how long you see, you feel, or you suggest that this product can be churned out, right? You have your roadmap to clearly at this point now define what you need to achieve at each particular time, at this particular period, right, to meet up with your milestone, to meet up with the timing you've set for your milestones, right? So your milestone is what you need to achieve at a particular period. Your milestone is a functionality or a goal you need to achieve at a particular period. Your roadmap breaks it down into many functionalities that you're going to achieve at giving certain time or giving time period, right? So Chinyere, does this answer your question? Okay, thank you. So in the case where you do not have an analysis on your team, how did you go about doing analysis on your end? So if I'm being sincere, there are actually product analytics tools that you use, right, to do your research on your own. But I have never used any of these analytics tools. I never had a time to use any of these analytics tools. Right? And basically because I've mostly worked on startups, right? Still, time when we had to use this, where I had the data analytics was a company that has been marketing for almost 10 years, so they had gone to a point where they could have a data analyst that could do everything for the company. By the time I did my analytics, right, was a time where basically where I worked in device management. our system was breaking at particular points. The data we were getting system hang at a particular point. Number one, this is what I did to help me. On the production side, I had an account on my own to track behavior, right? And I had dummy devices to track behavior. On the other hand, because it was a startup and we're test running with some people, I had them agents that I interact with. And how do I interact with that agent? Depending on who the agent is. For some, I interacted with them on WhatsApp. For some, I had a Slack channel dedicated to each of these agents where they give me insights or data by telling me when I get to the 100 limits, when I get to the limit of 100 for device configuration, I can't do more configuration again, right? I track that behavior across all other agents, right? So we had someone we're test running with. I was like, configure 100 devices today and give me your feedback. When it got to 100, number 101 configuration, or like, oh, I'm experiencing the same issue at number 101. On my own part, I took dummy data, did a bulk configuration of 100 to see system behavior, right? Then did another bulk configuration of 102, to be precise, to see the different behaviors. At that point, I knew that when you go beyond 100, there's a problem. Right, that was the data I was tracking at that particular time. So because the product I was working on, we didn't require data analysis, we didn't require an analytic tool, right, to track user performance. So something I can do across board with my agent and something I could do on my own, right? Those were ways I used to in getting data insights, right, to track what system was doing, right? So on the other hand, there are systems you can use to track this insight. I've never used any one of them. I can't point an example now. I think Google Analytics tool, Google has one, right? And what they just usually do is when you register an account, you should be able to know where users are dropped. Probably you test it out with them, something like Facebook or Twitter, to know the places users are clicking on most on those applications or on your application, depending on what you want to use it, right? They have the paid plan, depending on where you want to. You want to know where users are clicking on your system. You want to know where they are dropping off on your system. You want to know the places where users are staying on your system, right? There are tools you can use to determine that, right? There are a lot of them are around. But I think the most used one is the Google Analytics tool, so you can use that. I have never used it, right? I've just watched tutorials on how they are done, right? But those are other ways you can do that on your own. You're welcome. I don't know if I have any other question. Hello, can anybody hear me? Do you have any other questions? Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you so much for the. I think I'm done here. Thank you so much, everyone, for having me. And I'll take care.
Thank you, Joyce.